Recently, I had to do a security review of a VS Code extension and language server. But I know nothing about VS Code extension security. What is the attack surface? What could go wrong? But I need to know this to properly review the code, right? So the question is, how can I do my work if I don't know this stuff? Well, the answer is first, I obviously need some general experience on how computers work and how software works and how that stuff can break. But then I also need specific knowledge about the topic. So how do I learn about it? Well, I can start by looking around what others have published on the topic. And you can find a few resources out there about the security of VS Code extensions, like a blog post by Vasco Franco of Trail of Bits or an article by Rael and Kirill. But when you want to become a security professional, you cannot always rely on existing material. Even in this case, you only have a handful of resources. And think about this, how did those authors come up with their articles in the first place? Well, the answer to that is security research. These articles are basically the result of research. So in order to do good work, I have to do security research on VS Code extensions myself. And in this video, I want to take you along one particular research area that I investigated with VS Code language servers. So, what is a language server? Luckily, there's a great guide from the official VS Code documentation explaining it. Language server is a special kind of Visual Studio Code extension that powers the editing experience for many programming languages. With language servers, you can implement autocomplete, error checking, called internally diagnostics, jump to definition, and many other language features. And here's generally how the architecture looks like. Let's say you want to add HTML or PHP language features like checking for syntax errors or autocompletion, then you create a VS Code extension to do that. And part of this extension is the actual VS Code extension itself, the language client. It's your code running within VS Code as an extension. But then your extension executes another process, another program, which is the respective language server. And they communicate using the language server protocol. By the way, if you find the term server and protocol confusing, it just happens so that I made a video about these terms recently. So check out those videos and then hopefully it makes sense. Now, this article also refers to a language server sample code, which is a minimal example of how to implement that. For security research, it's always important to have examples to look at. Essentially, we are looking here at a library or framework, the VS Code extension API and the way how to implement language servers. So you need to know how the library is actually used. For example, from the guide, we just learned that the extension executes the language server process. So this library somehow provides code execution, right? But that doesn't mean the library has a remote code execution vulnerability. It now depends on how exactly the language server process is started and how developers use the library, whether it's easy to make mistakes that lead to RCE or it's unlikely to do so. So that's why it's important to have realistic example code. And here it is, the LSP sample. From the README, we can learn how to set it up. I don't need to go into the details here. You can follow those steps yourself. Now, let's have a brief look over the structure of this code. Here we have a server, so that's the language server, and we have a client, that is the actual VS Code extension. This extension code is very minimal. On activate, that's like the main entry point for the VS Code extension, it will create a server module path, configure the server options, configure some client options, passes it to the language client, and starts it. So this is apparently how executing the server process works. Here we specify the path to the server program, and I guess client start will then launch the process. So regarding our previous question about the remote code execution, is this an issue for this library? Theoretically, you could write some weird code where you assemble the server path dynamically based on the attacker controlled data, and that could lead to arbitrary code execution, but it's incredibly unlikely. The extension and server go hand in hand, and I can guarantee you that even without actually checking, in every case, the path is gonna be hard coded. So that's uninteresting and useless for us. Wrong, you are wrong. This is not uninteresting. We just did security research. We identified a potential security issue based on our prior experience. We understood that if this path is attacker control, it would lead to an issue. And remember, our job as a professional, it is to do a security review of some other VS Code extension and language server. Albeit it being unlikely to be an issue, we can still go and check that in our other projects. So all in all, we did good work here. We did what was asked from us, even though it led to nothing. Anyway, let's move on. There's actually another thing I really wanted to look at. But before we get to that, let's look at this example code in action. What does it do? The README tells us how to compile and run and debug this project, so let's go ahead. It will launch a new VS Code instance with our VS Code extension, the client, and it will then execute the server. We can now create a new document and enter some example text. And look at the squiggly lines appearing. The uppercase any is flagged. Any is all uppercase. And this is the result of the language server. The language server has a bit more code, but most important is that it reacts on changing content. So when the content of an open text document changes, it will execute the validate text document. And there's a regex where it looks for uppercase words, length of two and more, and then loops over all matched words and creates so-called diagnostics. It creates a warning saying that the word is all uppercase. And then it uses the connection between the client and the server to send back the diagnostics about this file, which then the VS Code client receives and turns that into the warnings here. Any is all uppercase. So you just saw the VS Code extension and the language server in action. The client sets up an external process, a server, and asks it to analyze the open code. And the server then can send back information like warnings about the code. It's just a toy example flagging uppercase words, but you can see what it does. So what's next? There's actually one area that I find incredibly important to investigate, and that is communication. That is the important word whenever you have multiple components, especially server and client, that communicate with each other. As a security researcher, you should ask yourself a few questions. First question is, how is the communication done? Is it something like an HTTP API, web sockets? Is it raw TCP sockets, UDP? Does it use pipes and IPC features, inter-process communication offered by the operating system, like pipes in Windows or Mac ports in Mac? There are tons of ways how communication could be implemented, and it's important to figure out what it uses. And then this leads to the second question. Can an attacker mess with that? So we are basically trying to identify the attack surface. Generally, we only need to review code that can be reached by an attacker, but without knowing what we can reach, we don't know what to review. So discovery of the threat surface is a very important part of security research. And that's what we have to do now. And in the client code, we can actually see here a reference to transport kind IPC, inter-process communication. But what other types of transport kinds exist? I guess it's time to look into the code of the VS Code language server library itself. We can easily find the GitHub repository for the NPM module, which includes the client, server, protocol types, and JSON-RPC, the underlying message protocol. If you have a GitHub account, you can hit dot on your keyboard and drop into an in-browser VS Code to now explore the sources. In the search, I always like to exclude test. Tests are a great place to see how developers intend certain functions to be used, but oftentimes I don't want to get distracted by it. I will seek it out when I specifically want to. This leaves us with the main.ts file containing a lot of if checks for different transport kinds. And we can also find the enum defining the different methods. We have SCD in and out, IPC, pipe, and socket. I guess there's no HTTP API, which means attacks from browsers with HTTP requests are not possible, right? Well, each transport kind may or may not have different risks whether an attacker can even reach those endpoints or not. Especially IPC and pipes usually are only interesting for local attackers that already have code running on the machine. So we think more about privilege escalations. But regular TCP sockets are still very interesting. Maybe they are listening on all interfaces, meaning that an external attacker on the same network could talk to the TCP server. But also web browsers speak TCP. Well, web browsers speak HTTP, but HTTP is built on top of TCP. And if you have played CTFs before with SSRF challenges, or for example, you have watched my GitLab CTF walkthrough, you know that sometimes you can use HTTP or other protocol requests and target other TCP-based protocols and mess with that. So in my brain, I start to wonder, what can I do here? But first, we need to get a better test setup, which means I want to change the sample code from using transport kind IPC to transport kind socket. Looking around at other examples implementing this, we have to specify the transport kind and a port. And now when we launch our extension, we don't notice anything different. However, using Netstead, we can see that two different processes have established a TCP connection on that port. And using Wireshark, listening on loopback localhost interface filter for the port, we can even observe the communication between the VS Code extension and the language server. So restarting VS Code again to trigger the whole message flow, and then we can find it in Wireshark. And with follow TCP, we can look at the complete TCP exchange. And so here you can actually see the JSON RPC protocol in action. So when in the server code, we write connection send diagnostics, passing over the uppercase warnings, the library actually sends out this JSON RPC message. It seems to start with a content length followed by JSON data. And this contains a method name, text document publish diagnostics, followed by the additional data like start and end line along the warning message is all uppercase. As you can see, this is just JSON data sent over TCP between the VS Code extension client and server. And fun fact, if you look at the sending direction, the VS Code extension client actually opened the TCP port and the language server connected to it. So while this component is called a language server and this is the client, if you look at the TCP layer, this started a TCP server and this is actually the TCP client. I thought that's interesting if you watched my What is a Server video. Anyway, my research question, my security research question is now, can we send malicious JSON RPC messages from a browser, send a fake diagnostics to VS Code? On first sight, this doesn't seem so because these are clearly not HTTP requests, right? Also, when you use Netstead to look for TCP ports, the port is actually not listening, it's established, meaning the server stopped listening after a client connected. This is actually a really good design. There's no reason to support multiple TCP clients in this case. Once the language server connected, you don't need to listen for more. But I did write a quick Python script to test whether we can raise this. So basically, the script tries to connect to the TCP server and send a fake JSON RPC data. And when we relaunch the extension, we maybe connect before the server can connect. And then, yeah, we send malicious data. But you have to get very lucky, and in practice you only have one chance when VS Code is launched. So this really minimizes the threat surface a lot, which is good. But theoretically you can definitely win the race and connect to the port before the real language server does so. So we can finally tackle the big question. Can we send malicious requests from a browser from a malicious website? To answer this, I had to look into the JSON RPC implementation, specifically the message parsing. I knew it was looking for the content length, so this is a good starting point. Looking for this in the code, it led to here, a function on data, and it calls here headers get content length. Looks like even though no other headers exist, here in principle it supports other headers. And this is great news. Remember, this is how a typical post request in a browser looks like. You have a bunch of headers, including the content length and the body. And this part looks like JSON RPC. But does it accept the other garbage? I tested this with the Python script and a notification test, prepending some fake headers, and it works. Which means this whole part is valid JSON RPC. Incredible. But we have a problem, because the first line of HTTP, the request line, is not a header. And if you would send this, it would fail. This is not valid JSON RPC. But do you have an idea? This requires creativity in hacking. Well, how is a header defined? Probably key colon value. So why not add a colon here? And this works. By sending a post request to a path containing a colon, it turns this first line into what looks like a fake header, key and value. And the JSON RPC code accepts this. Does this mean we can actually attack VS Code extensions from the browser? Well, long story short, no. Turns out, before you can send a malicious JSON RPC message, you need to respond to the initialized message, responding with your capabilities, which means you need to send two JSON RPC messages after another in the same TCP exchange. I actually first thought it would work. I thought the browser maybe uses HTTP pipelining under the hood, so two HTTP requests are appended and sent along the same TCP session. But turns out HTTP pipelining in browsers is not really a thing anymore. The option to enable pipelining has been removed from Chrome. So you can send the JSON RPC response, but you get no chance to send an actual malicious JSON RPC message. Which means in the end, this idea of attacking VS Code language server extensions from the browser does not work. This is failed research. Sorry for wasting your time. Well, with this video, I wanted to show you how research can look like. And many times research will be fruitless. This is the essence of the scientific process, and it's okay to fail. I think in the end, I still learned a lot about VS Code extensions, and along the way, you probably discover other attack ideas as well that you can then test for. So to me, this is a very important part of my job doing code reviews, and hopefully I was able to give you a glimpse into this kind of work. Also, I did a lot of this research on stream recently, so if you are wondering how long this research actually took, well, you can watch it in real time on my second channel, Live Underflow. It took us around 3 to 4 hours to do this. So if you are interested in more of the technical details or follow along and try out some other ideas you have, check it out. And tell me in case you find anything interesting. Speaking of work, have you ever tried to do code review using a shitty font? I would not recommend it, but if you hate yourself and you want to try it, check out my handwritten font. It definitely makes code reviews worse, so check it out on shop.liveoverflow.com. This is like digital merch. You can support this channel with a one-time purchase and get something somewhat useful out of it. Besides that, I also appreciate patrons and YouTube membership. Thanks to everybody who bought the font or is a member. I really, really appreciate it. Thank you so much.